Committee. My name is Stuart Kelly, I'm the Chair of the Committee. Could I please ask that all mobile phones are turned off or to silence? This meeting will be webcast and the record retained on the Council website. The Council is set to follow the microphones. Members, please remember to use your microphone when speaking. If the applicants, petitioners or agents do not wish to be filmed, please let me know before you take your seat to speak. My role is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people are, to my right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on procedural and legal matters that may arise, and the minute taker and webcasters. To my left are the planning officers, highway engineers and environmental health officer, who will present the applications and provide any technical advice that may be required. Down the sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications and collectively make the decisions. Voting will be by a show of hands. Each application will be introduced by the planning officers. Where there is a qualifying petition of 25 signatures or more, I will invite a representative of the petitioners to address the committee for 5 minutes. I will then invite the applicant or their agent to address the committee 5 minutes. Statutory and local consultees may also address the committee. A ward councillor can also address the committee. Once representations have been made and following any questions of clarification committee members may have, the speaker must return to the public area and may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. When making decisions, members may only have regard to material planning considerations. It's a matter for each member individually to balance these considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members will also have regard to our local planning policies and to the national planning framework and guidance. Okay. We have a short agenda tonight, which I propose just to take to order. So the first item on the agenda is members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interest in connection with any application on the agenda, and if so, to declare them and state the nature of the interest.
Just for the avoidance of doubt, I'm not standing by.
Agenda item 2 then, minutes of the meeting on the 12th of September to approve the accuracy of the minutes of the meeting. Is that agreed? Agenda item 3 then, application as 155-157 Brighton Street, EGREMONT. Could the officer introduce?
This application is for conversion of a vacant antique store into 2 6-bed HMOs together with a small single-storey extension to the rear. The two units will be self-contained with no internal links but will share facilities to the rear, such as cycle storage, waste collection and a laundry room. The property is within a primarily residential area and the principle of converting this vacant retail unit into residential use is considered acceptable. Based on the search of planning applications in the area, together with liaison with the council's housing team, it's considered that there isn't no concentration of HMOs within the area, with no HMOs operating within the neighbouring properties. In terms of means for future occupiers, each of the rooms have an integral ensuite, sufficient outlook, and are considered to be of a suitable size for licensing standards. The communal living area, together with a kitchen dinette, is provided on the ground floor. There's a small yard area to the rear to accommodate bikes, waste, and laundry. Overall, it's considered that the proposal provides acceptable living conditions for future occupiers, and on this basis, the application is recommended for approval, subject to the attached conditions. Thank you.
Thanks, Russ. There's no petition. Is the applicant here? Hello? In which case, I'll invite any more councillors who wish to address Adrian.
There's no surprise when people wish to invest money into providing homes that can be rented to people. After all, there's a shortage of housing, and there's a shortage of housing in particular at rents that people can afford. So there's no objection to the principle of what's happening, but the objection that I have is to the particulars of what's happening. When we see a former family business, and this has happened in many cases where in the past the family would have lived over the shop in a very normal and healthy, functional way. But when we see that particular business tradition slowly disappearing, and former commercial premises, and indeed former family houses being changed into multiple occupation to the extent it's happening and in the manner in which it's happening, then it causes enormous concern. My ward has been particularly blighted by the rapid change of former family homes and former small businesses into multi-occupancy. Very frequently, the people who take up the accommodation to let in these premises are themselves in not very sound financial health. Many of them perhaps even have what a colleague on the council used a very appropriate term, have multiple needs. And in some cases they need rather more support than they're going to automatically get in multi-occupancy. But when we have 10, 12, or a dozen individual bed sitting rooms, sometimes with shared accommodation, with shared living rooms, sometimes with shared lavatories, sometimes with shared kitchens, we are today building tomorrow's slums. The over-occupancy, the absolute concentration of so many people into buildings which were never intended to have that many people actually living in them, is beginning increasingly to blight areas. I could take you to parts of Seacombe where the people who live in a whole area don't even know each other, even though they live, in some cases, more frequently in the same buildings. They pass in the night. It's just not healthy, it's not proper. It really is an extremely unfortunate use of the buildings that we have to see people pressed into such cramped conditions. If you have a dozen people occupying a building of this sort, I think a dozen is the number, am I right? Does that mean they have 12 bins, or does it mean they're expected to share bins? It's improbable that they'll have 12 cars. But if you even have 3 or 4 cars, where on earth are they going to park them? This is already a densely overpopulated area. I just hope that councillors will do their very best to, if not stop this in its tracks, which I would prefer, at least make a statement of regret and objection that this sort of thing happens. Now, I know that if I ask you as councillors to vote it down and get it rejected, the chances are that your wishes will be ignored, because on appeal, it's quite likely that any decision you made would be overthrown. But I do at least hope that tonight you will make a decision, if you possibly can, to reject this, because we really do need the investors, in inverted commas, who are putting money into these sort of things, to kindly put their money into some other investment which is less harmful to the population in which my residents have to live. Mr. Chairman, if anyone wants to ask me a question, I'd be quite happy to answer it, but I think I've made my point pretty clearly. I believe that what we are doing when this sort of thing is passed by our council is we are creating today tomorrow's overcrowding and slums. I rest my case.
Any questions for Councillor Joe? Thank you for your presence. I'll open to the committee now.
From a planning point of view, there aren't any minimum requirements at the moment, but for licensing terms, it's approximately 6.5 square metres, and all of these rooms, you're ranging from just over 10 square metres to up to 18 square metres. So, I say, although there's no requirements for planning, based on licensing requirements, we're satisfied that they are substantially larger.
Sorry, just a follow-up question, thank you. So is it
So 6.5 is effectively the minimum standards for a single person room, and these rooms range from just over 10.5 to 18. So even the smallest room is substantially larger.
I take on board entirely the councillor's point of view. However, we have to realise that this area was at one point in time part of what was a great initiative called the housing market renewal. So the housing market renewal area, which the funding was taken away. I think the plan for that was to tackle what is a nationwide problem, particularly in this particular area, where the sort of retail elements of town centres were struggling, and in many cases the money would be used to actually take down these properties and build houses and windows and the like. That money was currently taken away. We now face, if you do actually look at this area, that we have a plethora of disused shops, disused retail premises that either in one case fell into the road or need some sort of future use. We also have a housing problem, as the councillor identifies. We particularly have housing problems for people to actually get into housing from at a very basic level. This is at a basic level, let's be honest about that. So, but many people need to start something, and this is the start they will get in their life and move on, hopefully, through the housing market to be, you know, potential homeowners or whatever. So, my view is that we have seen many of these applications, and I read from the report that we have had input from the housing people. They've been around, they give advice, the developer has taken on board the advice. And in comparison to some of the applications that have either found favour or found favour through appeal, this is not the worst we have seen in this committee. So my view is that it's tackled the need, it's renovated buildings that are falling into dilapidation. We are, for members of the public, we are working hard on a HMO policy that will give us more teeth and more weapons to actually improve the standard. But there will always be a need, whether you like it or not, especially in Britain where, you know, austerity has been the key word for years, there will be some basic housing need for all people in life at some point. So I take on board entirely the fears and applications. But in terms of this application and others we've seen, my view would be very difficult to defend that appeal. And even if what seems to be the embryonic part of our plan and policy, this would probably fit in. We haven't dotted all the I's and all across the T's, but this would probably pass through that sort of safety net that we're trying to impose. So my view is that it's an application that is worthy of support.
Well, yeah, that's it, but
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I've listened very carefully to what the local council has said. I also attended the site visit last Friday morning, which was very useful. Now, as I understand it, no objections have been raised either by other residents or any other, you know, environmental health, traffic or whatever, to the application. There's no petition. The bedrooms themselves appear to be larger than usual. I'm certain I can't find any reasons, any planning reasons, why we would have the opportunity to reject the application. And on the specific point that the local council suggested, well, why don't we just reject it anyway and just hope we win the appeal? I mean, I'm not too comfortable with that because, as I understand it here, perhaps we can clarify. I understand that if we take a decision to reject an application and then it does go to appeal, if we're then seen as having been unreasonably reject the application, there could be financial penalties or whatever against the council. So I wouldn't be happy with the situation where we reject an application on the basis that, well, we can't really see any good grounds for rejection, but we're just going to hope that, you know, the appellant agrees with us. I think we're leaving ourselves wide open for financial penalties, and I think that would be irresponsible of the planning committee to go down that road. So for those reasons, Chair, I'm likely to support the application.
Thanks, Pat. I'll take Ian and I'll come back to Paul. Just a request from the back of the room for members to get closer to the microphone so that the speakers pick up what's being said.
Thanks, Chair. Before I make any comments, can I ask the planning officers on this particular application? It is 155 to 157 Brighton Street, so clearly two addresses. And the application states it is two lots of six-bedroom HMOs. So this isn't one application for 12, is it? Is this two separate applications for six? Or how are we looking at this application?
I mean, from my point of view, they are self-contained. So they're two separate units of six bedrooms in each. But they do share some communal facilities, externally. It's one planning application, but we class them as two separate units. It is 12 bedrooms overall.
Okay, so that leads me to my next question. I understand that if it's six bedrooms or more, it has to come within the purview of the housing team. As this is two separate applications on paper for two lots of six, does that mean it doesn't come under the housing regulations that we operate under?
Well, I spoke to housing, they've said that it's five occupants or more in each unit requires a licence, so they will require a licence in this licence.
Thanks for that one. But I can just make some general comments then, kind of in relation to what Councillor Foulkes raised and the points raised by the ward councillor in the concerns that he's mentioned as well. In the, I think it was Councillor Stuart's in the representations, Councillor Stuart says the reason for asking for its removal is an over-concentration of HMOs in the area. Yet later in the report we're told that there isn't a concentration of HMOs in the area. And when we look at the addresses that the council tax department has looked upon, it's quite a narrow area, half a dozen houses, it looks like, in either direction. In terms of planning terms, what do we look at as an over-concentration in a particular area? How big an area are we looking at in planning terms?
I mean, I don't, there's not a set limit in terms of the distance. I think the policy talks about it within a block. So, realistically, for this property, just to get the map on, we would. Realistically, we could make the argument that you want the property next door and then the residential on the other side. That's a block. There's no definition of how far we should cast the net effectively.
I can just make a couple of comments then in terms of observations, having attended the site visit like many of the members of the committee. This application, like many of the HMOs we've had before, accepting Councillor Foulkes' point that it meets the demand, I also feel that these applications, when approved, create the demand. Because somebody who, as Councillor Adrian Jones referred to, somebody who is financially in distress, will clearly go for the lowest option housing-wise. Financially, because they will look to spend the least on housing costs possible. And this is where a lot of these HMO applications are coming in, because they know that they're dealing with people who are particularly vulnerable and have, as Councillor Jones referred to, particularly complex needs. If the decent homes standard that the previous government, to give credit to the previous Labour government, the decent homes standard that was applied to public sector housing that standard was applied to HMOs, most of these would never be approved for the reason that they've got shared facilities and the space that's available to them. I don't feel that we should be approving these applications simply because they are not public sector housing. If this was public sector housing, it wouldn't be approved. And yet, because it's private sector housing, we're told that we can't, we might risk it going to appeal, as Councillor Kenny said. Well, on that basis, we'd approve everyone in case we lost it on appeal. It may not be the worst that we've seen, as some of the ones that we've seen in Cllr Cross. I think this time last year was one of the worst ones that we've seen. And this committee, I think, unanimously refused that application. I don't believe that this is about meeting a housing need. I think this is about not having a vision for the area. I accept what Councillor Foulkes said about the Housing Market Renewal Initiative funding, but if, you know, if I wanted to make a political point, this is the same council that found £26 million to build a golf resort at Quarry Lake. So if we want to make political points, we can do that all night. But that doesn't... Sorry, I haven't finished. My point is, these standard HMOs do not improve that quality of housing, either in this particular area of Seacombe or in the borough as a whole. So I would agree with Councillor Burns. I'd like to hear Councillor Stewart's comments in terms of the over-concentration, so there is a difference of opinion in the report. But from what I've seen so far when I went on the site visit and what I've heard from Councillor Adrian Burns, I am minded to refuse this application.
Okay, thank you, Chair. I did pull this off the delegation because in my opinion there is an over-concentration in the area of HMOs. Former homes, that three-storey homes that have also been turned into flats. Now, technically, they aren't HMOs because they're flats. But in the roads on either side, so interesting that the points that Councillor Lewis raised is how far that sort of search went with regards to HMOs. Either side of this building, Foulkes Road, Clarendon Road, certainly the Foulkes Road, almost all the one side of the road has been turned into flats, bedsits. And for me, in that area, whether they're flats or bedsits, that you've got former homes that have been turned into multiple occupancy in one way, shape or form. I've lived in the area all my life, and I've only ever known that building to be what it is at the moment. So, and to anybody else in the area, it is one building that's been turned into two, and then turned into six, two lots of six HMOs. And that's what it will be to everybody in the area as well. So, you know, that building's been knocked through on every level. It is one building, called in two numbers, you know. It's now being converted back. Why? I did believe the same thing, that it was six, and then you don't have to have a housing license. I've investigated into that and found the same answer as well. So they still have to have a license in any case. I appreciate the comments that Ian Lewis said tonight, because I wholeheartedly agree with them. I've struggled to find a reason to move that the you know, for legal grounds refuse this. This is over-proliferation, over-concentration of houses and former shops being converted into flats and HMOs in the area, and we should be encouraging investors, in inverted commas, and landlords to build high quality, affordable homes for the future, for the aging population, so that we're not having to shuffle people around. This is not going to be suitable housing for people for long term. It is targeting a specific type of clientele, and that type of clientele are going to be, potentially could be used and abused by unscrupulous landlords, because of their specific needs. And I agree with my board colleague who says that we, you know, by allowing these to happen, we are creating tomorrow's slums today. And we're creating problems on our doorstep. This wouldn't happen in other wards. You know, you only have to look at the second application here. It's a only certain areas that this kind of thing happens, and we need to take a stand on this, and I will be supporting any proposal to refuse this tonight, because I really do think that we should have better standards for our housing.
Sorry,
I don't disagree with Councillor Stuart that we should be encouraging landlords to build the best quality for the best affordability for residents. But I think, and it's not whether we agree or disagree on this evening, but I think there will be some people who it's either a HMO or nowhere, and it's to Councillor Cox's point, this might be the best option that some people have, and it's not to say when it's the best option then you should take whatever you get, it should be absolutely the best quality. But I do think we need to recognise that this type of housing will pay a lot, and if it is short term and if it is temporary and it is for a specific group of people in society, there is still that doesn't mean that there's no need there. It might be short term and temporary in a specific group because that's what they need. So it's not to say it shouldn't be good quality, but we can't, I think, dismiss that there is a need there of some sort that has to be met at the best quality, absolutely, but there may still well be a need.
Thank you, Chair. Just some clarification from the other panel. I think you mentioned in terms of opening remarks with regards to it's not deemed that there is over-concentration of HMOs. And again, my colleague and Paul both touched on that as well. But am I correct in saying, particularly without making any political points again, we haven't got an active local plan, but within the guidance then, there isn't actually any specifics as to what would constitute over concentration of HMOs, because whilst you just said, well, you look at a corner or a block, I would suggest that somebody's frequented the gym just up the road at King Street. If you look out from the window and watch what is taking place there, nearly all of the old shops there are probably either flats or houses of multi-level occupation. That's only a few hundred yards up the road. So if there is no guidance, does that not mean that it is subjective as to what area we actually take as meaning over-concentration? It might be open to appeal, but we could actually deem that it is over-concentration regardless.
Yeah, I mean, there is some guidance, but I'll read out what it says. It says existing HMOs and valid planning permissions must not comprise more than 20% or more of the properties forming the street frontage within a street block. Now, there's no definition of what a street block is. You could say interchange between the two roads, and that would be quite a small search. We could expand that search a bit further and not found any other HMOs, but I agree, there's no clear definition.
Thanks, Chair. Quite frankly, I find it a disgrace that in 2019 we have applications like such as this that will come before us. In terms of legally, this is acceptable as a full attendant or acceptable in planning terms or bulk number in design terms or whatever in today's society. Now, we're talking about concentration, but I know for a fact, maybe all the way from Seacombe, as far as we're staying, there's a whole raft of former retail units being converted to third quality flats, and having HMOs and it creates a it doesn't do anything to create a community, because you end up with a transit population coming in and out. But no community spirit, and as Asian says, we end up creating more slums today. Now, we want to lift it, and we've got a great place ambitions for it, and that's prosperity. But how the hell are we going to be able to attract investors to go invest in the city?
3.12.3 does set out which properties were purchased. So we've gone up to here, then following here, down into Foulkes Road, then across down to number 2, or down, and then these two blocks diagonally opposite.
Thank you, Chair. Sorry, I did see that in the report, but I wasn't sure from what you were saying whether you were indicating that you'd gone further. So, the point that I raised is that had that search gone up on either side on those two roads, then I'm sure it would have turned different. And as colleagues have already said, you only have to go down King Street, Brighton Street, and it would have turned different view. But I accept the point that there is no defined.
Well, there's no defined, but it talks about, as you said, in a block, which doesn't define what the block is. So the search area was supposed to be as wide as was interpreted, if you like, by Prime Officers on the what was meant by a block of housing. Okay, we've had a look at this. I think there's a number of issues that arise, as always, with applications like this. Obviously, it's a vacant building now, falling into some disrepair. That's not going to reflect very well on what is a main road in and out of the area. Any sort of development, like, you know, one way to learn, any sort of development would naturally, hopefully, improve certain frontage. The idea that it could be brought back into a retail use is probably just whistling in the wind these days. In terms of the original drawings that we've seen, and I've often cast my votes against HMOs where the standard of amenity inside the HMO is less than I would find acceptable, particularly with regard to access to toilets and washing facilities. And the original drawing had a toilet cracked in under the stairs, which I thought was unacceptable, and that was fed back, and that was altered. So each of the flats has its own toilet and washing facilities, which is a lot better. The only shared facilities are the broadly the kitchen and if you like the communal areas. In terms of the strategic aspect of it, we don't have that information in front of us. How many HMOs do we need? Do we not need? We're not as advanced in our policy making to be able to say we actually don't need any more. There is demand for these this type of accommodation. The point is well made about where the grounds in the past and those that we've succeeded on, you know, because we have succeeded on appeal. It has been on the ratio of residents to amenity and on room size, and none of those things are present. In this. So certainly I know people have asked, can I think of any sort of other strike rate, some you win, some you lose, and I can't. Nevertheless, we will test, members will have balanced all the issues in their heads, and we will just test that now in a binary vote and see where we go. So just to save the embarrassment of anybody, because none of us are particularly happy with this sort of thing, I'll move approval and see where that takes us. Yes.
Sorry, I'd like to at least put it out there that I would want to move for a few on over development and over concentration of HMOs in the area.
That's the first one that's been moved and seconded. I mean, I'm happy to take that, test the will of the committee one way or the other, and obviously you want that on the record. So we'll take that to the proposal. Do we want to make that any further or can we go
I've got to, as vice chair, I've got to sort of bring us back to the level of reality. We are the planning committee. We've spoken much about what we would like to see in the world we want to live in and be. We have to deal with the tools that are in front of us. And we are trying to improve our toolkit. We are discussing HMOs, which will help best define what is own conservation and what isn't, and put all of sometimes the reason for refusal is as vague as it can possibly be, because we've got any policies that it would be tested against. So technically, I think we send an officers in to appeal. Well, we'd be at the wicket without a bat, technically. And that's another point. You know, I understand all the sentiments. We are going to challenge these HMOs. We shouldn't be making a fool of ourselves with you know, not properly researched reasons for refusal. So I had to make that point as vice chair. But I've heard what's been said. I mean, it's an open vote. I'm happy to get on.
The point of fairness is well made, that normally a reason for refusal would have an evidence base. To not be quite so vague. But nonetheless, you know, it's moved on, and I'll take it. But I would say, you know, if it did go to appeal on those grounds, then the appeal decision, that appeal decision has weight. It has weight on further applications that we might be considering. So the danger becomes that we attempt to defend something on the basis of open concentration, fail because we have no evidence base to back it up, but nevertheless the inspector will then have put in the public domain for will something that will then carry weight if we wanted to try and rely on something like that when we actually might have had a better evidence base. But Cathy,
just before we go to the vote on either way, one of the issues is that we obviously don't have a policy ourselves for the Borough Council on HMOs, and that's been a bugbear for an awful long time. And I think it'll be sorted out, as I simply say, every time we get an HMO application, but until we get this sorted out, we're sort of whistling the wind slightly, and we don't have anything to back up a reason for refusal. Having said that, on the dimensions that are on these particular HMOs, if Rural Borough Council had adopted a policy on HMOs, would those dimensions fit the bill, or would we be aspiring to have a higher ratio of square footage of each flat? And also, if you're looking at what a rock should be and how many should be, or how far you widen your field, statistically, the wider you have the field, the more likely you are to meet the 20% plus ratio. And so, I don't know the area specifically, but obviously Stuart and Adrian do. Sorry, Paul. So, if you were to slightly widen the scope of where you are looking for an over concentration of HMOs, you might find that you only might have to go, you know, several yards one way or the other, and in front and back, and you actually might need the ratio then, in which case there may be grounds for a refusal being upheld at appeal if the ratio on that 20% was met. The other thing, I didn't speak earlier, but certainly we want all areas of the borough to be pleasant for people to live in. And I've always thought of HMOs that we should be bringing the level up and not coming down. And sometimes I think the more that we agree HMOs, whether or not we have to bite the bullet that goes to appeal, the more we are allowing developers to dumb down and go to the lowest common denominator. And I think it then has issues for people's mental health. It doesn't promote, as other councillors have said, for areas where people have community. And in HMOs, you're never going to have a family. You're probably never even going to have a couple. You're just going to have one person, necessarily. So I'm just wondering whether or not an officer, if there are not any grounds here that people can think of to move refusal, whether the officers can find a way around either a policy that's perhaps adopted in other areas that needs a basic test, or whether or not if you widen the scope of the search, that you can meet the basis of 20% plus.
Okay, so there's a couple of issues there. Obviously, members have done some work on the new HMO policy. And in terms of the areas, which is the first question that you presented us with, this would meet the requirements of the policy that we have. So the room sizes would take that policy. In terms of wider search areas, the wider the search area, the more it obviously is brought in. But it doesn't necessarily follow that you'll achieve you'll take the 20% box, because more houses that aren't HMOs will also be put at.
That's
right. Well, it may be better data, and it's a point that's been reasonably well made, and what the point is that we don't have a policy on this, and we can't make it up as we go along until it meets until it meets our arguments, if you like. We have 20% in a block, and that's been defined reasonably by, you know, planners. By looking at that block. Now we can say, well, if you go a little bit further one way and down another, you know, you start to get into the shape, if you like, of the gerrymander, don't you? And say, well, yes, I can achieve 20% if you go down this side of the open block, this, and that becomes complex. I understand the point that's being made. Now, if we need a policy in the emerging local plan about what sorts of search area we do for any sort of application, then we need a policy. That will not have been lost on us. However, we've heard what the policy says at the moment, it's about 20% of the blocks, and we can't just make it up. I mean, I'd love to make it up as a go along, often in the past, but it isn't possible. I'll take Steve again, and then I'll take Stuart. But then we will need to make some progress. We have a proposal.
Yeah, I mean, you know, inspectors do these things all the time, so they're going to see right through. Well, we came up with a reason for the because we decided to extend the area that we discussed to further the back and so on. It would seem like to that. They would see me that type of application. So what is reasonable is what plan officers have done and what plan officers all over the country would have been doing. And I'm getting very worried though that we are stigmatising people who live in HMOs to a point where I'm feeling very uncomfortable. I live in an HMO or HMO type. People in different parts or different stages of their lives need that type of accommodation for all sorts of reasons. Some people choose to spend very little on their accommodation and travel the world and do all sorts. Students live in this type of accommodation. To simply say everybody goes to the HMO, it is going to bring down the area. I think we have to be a little bit careful. And then it began to spread then. So if you live above a shop in Seacombe, you're some sort of, you know, you've got problems. Well, that's not true. I've got hundreds of. I know lots of people who live above shops, and they've lived above shops for all their life. It's known people who live above shops in Eswell, who live above shops in Seacombe. We're in danger here of sort of stigmatising people for this case because of that point in their life. They choose to take a cheaper housing option. So we just have to be a little bit careful going through user, and you know, hopefully, you know, we will get our policy right, and our policy will help us define what we need. We look at what a block is or what an area is. I just think we need to be a little careful with the language that we're using, if that's okay to you.
Thanks, Jim. So